Hey Bermuda, I'm sitting here in a nice little garden setting with my friend Linda Meinzer, and it's sort of sunset. You can probably see the sun twinkling through the trees here. But anyway, I sort of first became aware of Linda when I attended the Bermuda College, and also up at Berkeley when the Minister Pamplin had a couple of information sessions on same-sex marriage and so on and so forth. And I was really inspired by your story. And whilst I heard your story, and the people in that room heard your story, and we've seen some video stuff of you, I think it'd be a great time to tell your story again and how you feel about it.
Yeah, it's so funny because, you go through life and you're just kind of existing and you're doing everything that you're supposed to do in terms of filling boxes that you were told to fill when you were younger. And then you wake up and you're the achievement of everything you were supposed to do. But what I think what people don't understand that for a gay person, it's nothing like that. It's a constant turmoil once you realize that you're different. And for me, I would say that I knew I was different from young, like maybe 5, 6. I knew that I liked girls. I thought it was normal. And I remember being in primary school and having this incredible crush on one of my classmates and just thinking it was just normal, But then, you start to hear little pockets of dissent and you're like, okay, what's that about? And then I remember the turning point came for me when I was at a football game in Somerset. All Bermudians know that back in maybe the 80s, we used to go to football games as a family. We used to truck up to where either a Somerset Cricket Club or Rangers or Devonshire Rack. And I was up at the Somerset Cricket Club this one time, and a very known sort of gay person at the time walked past. And I knew that, well, I knew them, I had seen them around, so I sort of waved at them innocently. I think I may have been about maybe 14, and I sort of waved at this. And I remember my aunt, my mother's sister, but one of my mom's close friends that we called aunt. She says, "Don't you speak to her? Don't you wave at her? You know what she is?" And I'm like, "I don't know, just a girl. I mean, totally innocent. Like, oh yeah, she's just a girl. I see her around or whatever." And she's like, "No, she's not a girl. She's a dyke and all these. She just spilled off all these names." And I said, "Well, why do you say that?" And she's like, "Oh, because she likes girls." Imagine.
So the penny dropped, sort of in a sense of like,
Wow.
wow. I mean, the thing about it is, I don't know about you, but when I grew up, sex education was like the last thing anyone talked about. I mean, we had to guess at it. When I went to school, no one said anything about it. When I went to Whitney, when I went to Sol, then I went with Soltis, then I went away. My mother never discussed it. And I remember that when my father said to me, when I came home from school one time, he said to me, "Son, I need to sit down and talk to you." He said to me, "I just want to have a little conversation with you about the birds and the bees." Because Dad was so nervous. He was so nervous about it. He put it that way. So I said, "I know all about it, Dad." And he goes, "Oh, thank God.
Thank
Oh,
you.
I'm so, thanks, son. Okay, fine. What shall we have for dinner?" I mean, that was the extent of my sex
Exactly,
education from my
exactly.
parents. And schools didn't talk about it. The only thing for me was when I went to a Catholic school. And so sex was considered a sin. Masturbation was a sin. Girls were a sin. We were told when we were just about to leave my school, after just about to do my A levels. And we were given a lecture about women by the housemaster in my school. And he said, "Now I just want something to share with you, all you Catholic boys at Prior Park College," which is where I
Wow.
went in Bath. He said, women are the very agents of the devil himself and will lead you down the road to hell. So you know what? We all after the talk, we're going like, well, we want to go there.
Yeah, you know? Exactly.
So,
show me the women.
Show me the women. And then, of course, you know, I mean, your identity, you know, discovering yourself, what that journey's like. I mean, everybody discovers themselves.
Yeah.
Everybody, you know, somebody tells you about what masturbation is and you try it and you go like, well, this ain't so bad, you know, but you're told that it's, you're not supposed to do it.
Right.
So, but that's...
See, that's how it's supposed to be. It's supposed to be a normal transgression.
Right.
You know, with all of the pressures that come with knowing all of a sudden, from that point, I knew I was considered someone that something was wrong with.
But there was nothing wrong with you.
Yeah. And that's it. That's
what you start to think because other people are talking about, oh, he's a fag or she's a lesbian or it's this or it's that, you know.
But nobody counteracted it. Right. And part of the reason
And people
is,
made jokes about it back
right,
then.
Right. Part of the reason was because I wasn't going to tell anybody that, hey, I like girls too. I wasn't going to tell anybody because now I have this aunt that said that. So I was going to be put in that category. And I don't want my parents to know, or my friends to know, or my other relatives to know, because then I would be her. So automatically...
So you kept it a secret, right? That's what you do. You go underground.
I went underground. And I was so... I remember I was so, so disappointed. And I think that was around the time that I stopped talking. Like, I stopped communicating with people. I was very introverted. I used to go to school, come home, stay in the house. I only used to, you know, talk to my granny. And my granny used to always say, you know, you could be anything you want and you're going to be this amazing person. And I would be like, no, granny, you know, I'm just going to be ordinary because, you know, I just don't want people to know. And she would always be like, know what, you know? And I saw my grandmother, this woman, this strong black woman who used to get up every morning and walk to work. And she used to say, when I retire, I'm going to have this amazing life and we're going to do this and we're going to do that. And that was the only thing I hung on to. And then my grandmother died.
Uh-huh.
She died her 64th year.
Did you get a chance to share with her? No.
Nope. I didn't. But I did vow that day that I was going to live a life that I wasn't going to have to wait until I retired to live. You know?
Right.
And so there was something kind of brewing in me that was like, hang on, your time's going to come, your time's going to come, and you're going to have this opportunity to be who you are. But the more that I felt it, the more that people pushed against that. I used to hear all these things. I would be at work and people would be talking about gay people, and it was just, it was horrible. And so I said, you know what?
Do you think they said it in front of you just to get at you in some instances?
Who would know?
Right.
I did the right things. I wore dress. I wore makeup. Right. I dated a guy that I didn't really date because I never had sex with anybody because I was like, that's where I draw the line. But we dated, you know, we went out. So I was filling in all the boxes.
Ticking
to make
the boxes
sure
of being normal.
Exactly. Nobody would know anything. But inside, I was just falling apart. I was just continuously broken because I felt like a fraud.
Yeah.
You know, I just felt like, oh, every time I would have to put on a dress and makeup, I was like, oh my gosh, this is so not me. I finally got it when I heard this interview with Janet Jackson, and Janet Jackson said, when you see me, you see a skinny person, but when I look in the mirror, I see a fat person. And she was saying how the brain works, and I thought, that's exactly me. People see me, and they see me as this feminine woman, and they have, you know, I had on the makeup and the dresses. But when I looked in the mirror, I wanted to wear bow ties. You know,
right.
I was fascinated, always been fascinated with bow ties. And in my mind, I used to say, one day, you know, I'm going to wear this bow tie and I'm just going to walk outside and just be like, hey, this is me, right? And hope everybody doesn't kill me. But it all changed one day when I was just having, I was just in a bad place. And I remember going down by one of my favorite places, which is Watchman's Hill Park.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's a great spot. Yeah.
Yeah, I drove down there and I was contemplating driving overboard.
Oh my God.
I was just like, yeah. I'm done. Like, I can't, you know. And I remember sitting there.
That would have been too messy.
Well, yeah. I hadn't thought that far ahead. I was just like, I can't do it anymore. Yeah. You know, I just couldn't do it anymore. And so I sat there and I said, you know, God, people say that you hate me. Like, people say that you hate me and I'm going to go to hell. And because, you know, I've chosen this. And I said, but you know me, like, I didn't make a choice. I never consciously said, well, I have this option and I have this option. So let me decide what I'm going to do. I said, God, you know that, you know? And I said, just send me something to say that you care about me, you know? And it was so funny because I remember getting a text from my sister, and I had my nephew's picture as her ringtone. And when his picture came up, I thought, I couldn't do that to him because I knew how much he loved me.
Yeah.
You know, and I didn't want him growing up always having to wonder, like, why did my aunt leave me? I took that as a sign from God. And I remember the next day I called my aunt, my favorite aunt. I'm named after her, actually. My Aunt Linda, and I was just bawling. She's like, well, what's wrong? And I'm like, I got to come and talk to you. You know, I got to come in and talk to you and just tell you who I am. And she's like, well, I know who you are. And I'm like, no, you don't know who I am. Like, you don't know anything about me. And so I went to her house the next day and I came up to her. And I tell you, it was such a burden, because my aunt is, she's very religious. She's a Seventh-day Adventist. She's very strong in her faith. And, you know, she was just like, I'm always going to love you. Like, nothing can keep me from loving you, you know? And I think that's what I don't see now. I don't see religious people or so-called Christians saying, whatever it is, that's your thing. But we love you, you know? I hear, we hate you. You just want an extra special right. You're going to hell. It's not God's wish and blah, blah, blah. I don't feel that genuine affection. Mm-hmm. And I think that's the sad part, because this is what, 20 years later?
Yeah.
20 years later. And you're still telling young people that. And unfortunately, a lot of young people aren't as strong. So we're pushing them into drug abuse. We're pushing them into alcohol abuse. We're pushing them into literally leaving the island. So many young people have left the island because they can't stay in these 21 square miles and be fraudulent every day. I know for me, it was, let's take a simple conversation at work on a weekend. Oh, hey, what did you do this weekend? I say to my colleagues, oh, I did this, I did that, I had a great weekend, me and the kids went this way, me and the wife went that. What did you do this weekend? And I'm in the closet, oh, nothing. When really, I had a fantastic relationship with whichever girl I was dating at the time. I had a fantastic time, right. But I couldn't share it. And I don't think people understand that you're keeping people in prison.
Yeah.
And it's not right.
Let me ask you, how bad do you think it really is for the kids coming up today? Do you think it's still something that they really have to hide? Or do you think that because of the internet, are things starting to change? Are they changing? Can people feel comfortable in their own skin here yet?
I think that, and thank goodness, we have a generation that don't really care to a certain degree. But here's the thing. They may not care because they're just going to live their life. But what's forcing them back into the closet is they're going to suffer the consequences. of the homophobic people out there who don't want to hire them, of the homophobic people out there who don't want to rent apartments to them, for the people in their family that are constantly Bible bashing them, Bible bashing them.
Right.
You know,
is it really that? I mean, are there people? I mean, I'm a bit naive, but then I'm not a gay person that's had to go and find an apartment. But is it that happens? It really truly
Absolutely.
happens. It happens. And what about jobs? I mean,
Absolutely.
People don't get jobs because they're gay.
They're not going to come out and say that.
Right.
But you
yeah.
can rest assured it's happening.
Yeah.
I work, you know, I'm a unionist.
Yeah.
I hear the stories. I mean, we have people, obviously, people can't imagine that I'm the only gay person out in the workforce. Or even in the police department. You can't imagine that. It's not even realistic.
No.
Right? But nobody puts up their hand. So the fact that people are not putting up their hand tells you that there's still an incredible amount of fear.
Yeah.
It's still a lot for people to say, I just want to live my life.
Yeah.
But, you know, people might know in pockets, but they're not going to put up their hand because it's difficult. I mean, realistically, when you think of it, the only reason we're having a referendum is because the pressure of the churches.
Right. And that brings me to this point. You know, I cannot believe that the politicians in both parties are, I mean, when we talk about gay people having to be in the closet or self-impose themselves in the closet, I spin it around this way, that the politicians are in the closet. They won't come out. They won't come out and do the right thing for people here. It's shocking to me. I mean, I emailed Linda, I emailed every member of the PLP and every member of the OBA, and I got not one response back about support for marriage equality. Would you like to talk to me about marriage equality? Would you like to go on camera about marriage equality? You know, apart from Mark Pennegill, who has, and apart from Grant Gibbons, who's allowed us to do the LGBT colors, I know Suzanne Roberts Holzhauer is in favor, and I know Walton Brown Jr.'s in favor of it on the other side. But the rest, and the Premier has come out and saying he's in favor of civil unions. In fact, he's been posting so much stuff about President Barack Obama on his Facebook page lately that I think he might just vote yes, yes, you know, because maybe he's getting it. You know, they need to get it. They get it,
but,
you know?
But here's the thing that I find disturbing. One of the things that I've learned from my union trenches and traveling in my union capacity is that there is a sign that is reflected in all true leaders, right? True leaders have the ability to stand up with conviction and state their position, whether it's good or bad. And that's what I admire. That's what I admire about the true leaders that we've seen in the world.
So when true leaders like Barack Obama came up and said, I believe in same-sex marriage, and of course the Supreme Court were the ones that made that happen, because that's the way it went. And you've got Justin Trudeau in Canada, you know, there are other leaders around the world that say, this is what I believe in. They don't go, well, hang on a minute, what do the people in Hamilton Parish think about this?
Yeah.
Or what are the people? No, hang on a minute. What do you think about this,
right.
sir
what
or madam?
What do you think about it?
Yeah.
I have the utmost respect for anybody. You know, people say, oh, well, I don't like Maria Seaman because blah, blah, blah. I don't have anything personal against Maria Seaman. In fact, I respect the fact that she is not afraid to stand up and say what she believes. Even though it's fundamentally against what I believe, at least she stands up and says what she believes. I prefer that to somebody who's behind a closed door.
Right.
Making decisions
hiding
and not
from the
standing
issues.
Up.
Hiding from the issues.
When it is your responsibility as a leader to stand up and say what you believe. And it's also your responsibility in leadership to represent all of the people, not just some of the people, you know. But to do what's best for all of the people. So how do I feel? How am I supposed to feel as a taxpayer, as a law-abiding citizen, as someone who is on a daily basis making a contribution to this country, when you stand up and say, I'm not good enough?
Mm-hmm.
That I'm not good enough. That I don't have a right. to all of the things that the next person standing right next to me that may not be making a contribution to Bermuda has a right to.
Yep.
And that's what it's really about, you know. It's nothing for me. It's nothing to do with religion. You can believe, I've said it before, you can believe what you want to believe. I believe in the freedom of religion. Right. I'm not trying to dictate to you.
And as Al Sharpton said, you know, there's 1,000 different versions of Christianity in America. And when he talked about of his support of marriage equality, he said, listen, guys, this is about civil rights.
Yeah.
Religion's religion. Everyone can have their own different brand about what they believe in, but civil rights are civil rights. And you can't have somebody's rights being a little bit better than other people's rights. Or they're not equal rights.
Yeah.
I mean, why should I be able to marry? I can go down right now to go to any church and take a woman with me, you know, pay my sum up in a government building, get my marriage license or whatever, go get married. You can.
I can.
You can. And that sucks.
And here's the thing. You can do that without going into a church. You can do that as an atheist.
Right. That's right. And you know, the other thing I think is wrong with this referendum, and that is just, okay, so are you in favor of marriage equality? Yes. Are you in favor of civil unions? Yes. Well, or no, whatever, which way you're going to vote. But the thing about it is civil unions, this is sort of a cop-out for giving gay people a sort of almost the same benefits as we've got. But guess what? If I wanted a civil union with a woman, I couldn't get one. So what is equal about this? This is so unequal. It's absolutely a farce.
Oh my goodness.
Right? Am I right?
You want to laugh about it. You want to laugh about it because you say, well, these are the people entrusted with making it right. You know? And yet, we're making it just as bad. And I would like people to look at it this way. Everybody, when they talk about, well, not everybody, but the people that are most against marriage and marriage equality, they always try to talk about those people. They always try to talk about those people, or you people shouldn't. But I would challenge anybody in Bermuda to stand up and say, I don't have a gay person in my family.
I think that is a perfect, makes perfect sense to me, because there's not, I mean, I don't have to look two steps away to know somebody that I'm close with who's gay. And I think that you're right. I mean, that happens to everybody.
So you're... When you go to the polls...
So when you couldn't tell your grandmother, I mean, so you couldn't even tell your own family member, because that's how you were fearful of it.
Yeah.
And surely...
So if somebody would have asked my grandmother, do you have any gay people in your immediate family? She would have said, oh, no, I don't. No. But that's the point, right?
Right.
It's not that you don't. It's that you might not know. And right. Why don't you know? Because you haven't created a safe space. And that is your obligation as a parent, you know, to create a safe space for your child,
right.
To create a safe space for your family. I always think of this. I tell people all the time why I my room is bright orange, and my room is my sanctuary. When I step outside my house and I get beat up and people put me down and they run me down and they talk about me this way and that way, and I get, as I say, beat up on the outside, once I get in my door and I sit down with my father, who loves me regardless of whatever his religious beliefs are, I know that I have arrived at my sanctuary.
Right. But I'm going to tell you something, Linda, that this is a way through my eyes, and knowing who you are, the little bit that I've gotten to know who you are, and through, you know, your support of the journey for marriage equality here in Bermuda. But I can't tell you how many people tell me that Linda Meinzer is amazing. how wonderful she's come. You have been a beacon for so many people, and you should be able to walk down the street, and I'm sure you do, and stand tall and go, you know, I am so glad that I've stood up for my rights. I'm not afraid to speak out, and you haven't been afraid to speak out. You've spoken out publicly, and I see so many people say, this lady is brilliant. Yeah.
Well, I appreciate it. In fact, when I was driving over here, I was talking to my friend, and I was saying that, you know, for me, it's not about the impact on other people, but I'm glad there is an impact, because I'm glad that I'm being something for others that I didn't have.
Yeah.
But for me is, honestly, Tony, every day I am out in the trenches fighting for people's rights. I am out in the trenches, in the union trenches, fighting for people's jobs. And at that moment, when it's about me saving your job, they don't care what I do. They don't care that I'm gay. They don't care who I sleep with. They don't care who I want to marry. All they care about is I'm going to save their job. And I fight every day to do the right thing for people and
right.
their job.
That's great.
So why not take some of that energy and finally do something for me?
Let me ask you this, to sort of wrap things up a little bit. What is your hope going forward for Bermuda? And what is your hope for June 23rd? And if the result is positive for us, I mean, it's a non-binding referendum, so something still has to give, and the politicians still have to act. I mean, I think they're waiting for this opinion poll so that they can
act. An expensive opinion poll.
Oh, it's a very expensive opinion poll. To then maybe do something that they should have done of their own volition anyway. But so I'd like to just know, if we could wrap this up, where you'd like to see this go and what your thoughts are on it.
Ideally, I would have wanted Bermuda to be a shining example of equality all on its own. That would have been the ideal thing for me. I think we're a very small country, and we have the capacity here. We have brilliant minds here and people who truly believe in a better world here. I have no doubt about that. But unfortunately, we're going to have to go through this expensive opinion poll. And I might wake up on the 24th and find out that 53% of Bermudians don't want me to have marriage equality, or they don't want me to have civil unions. And I'll be okay with that, you know. I'll be okay with that, because I know, without a shadow of a doubt in my heart, that it is inevitable. It is inevitable. And I'm holding out hope that either the courts or the lawmakers will do the right thing. I absolutely believe that. And the reason why I believe that, because every day I see young people that are struggling. Young people that are struggling. And the saying is very true. You only feel it when it hits home. And I think enough people, if they just open up their eyes, and they look at their relatives, they look at their sons and their daughters, they'll remember their responsibility to ensure that they have an opportunity for happiness. There's this running joke that we have on my job, my colleagues in the police department I work with. They say, you know what, Linda? I don't know what's the big deal. I think you should be able to get married and be miserable just like the rest of us.
I've heard that before.
Yeah,
too.
We don't have no problem. You know, why should we keep you from being miserable, right? But for me, it would say, listen, the person that you love, you have absolutely every right to look at them side by side and say, you are the person I want the world to recognize as my love. Not just in Bermuda, but everywhere I go. And I think I deserve that. I think I've worked hard for that. I think that I have done everything that this country has asked me to do. I think that I have been a good person. But more importantly, I think that I've struggled enough through the whole ups and downs of love to finally be able to meet someone and make that person my partner, my wife, and well, I don't think anybody has the right to deny me that.
Well, I've been making a few promises to people. I already promised Ijimo and Clarence that, you know, when they come down here and get married when they can, and, you know, married in Bermuda, I would play at their wedding. I will do the same for you.
All right.
So it looks like I might be playing a few weddings. So on that note,
you might be busy.
I might be busy. So let's hope. And the final message to the people of Bermuda. What do we want them to do on June the 23rd?
I want people to go to the pools and not think about what their religious belief is, not think about anything, but giving their family member an opportunity for happiness, just like they have. So absolutely, I want you to vote yes.
Thank you, Linda Meinzer.